Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, pain. Is it all in the brain?
So I was just running in and when you saw me hop, that was just like a... Oh, it's like a crack. It's like a... you know, when a bone cracks or when something is... It was a shock of pain I felt. I've never felt anything like that before.
Welcome, everybody. Good to have you here with us tonight. Ryan, you're one of the best fast bowlers in the world, hoping to play for Australia in the Ashes. You say that pain is your constant companion.
It's my friend.
It's your friend. Yeah. Why?
Well, I guess with everything I do and what I do and the stress I put on my body, I've always got it. I've always had it since I was, you know, probably 12 or 13 when I started bowling at a decent pace.
How intense is the pain that you feel when you're on the cricket field?
Yeah, it sort of differs, I guess, or varies from day to day. But when I'm actually bowling, it's probably the less. It's at its less painful.
You say your knee gives you the biggest
yep.
trouble. Tell us about that.
So I've got a bad knee, basically, where I'm bone on bone, inside and out. You know, obviously the way I land, the way I twist. But it's as I said, it's a day-to-day thing. I have really good days and I have really, really bad days.
Bone on bone, and you're putting that amount of pressure on your body. I mean, just describe for people who might not understand how yep. intense that pressure is that goes down onto your knees and your feet.
Joints and ankles. So basically up between 6 and 9 times your body weight goes through our joints. So I'm a right-hander, so my left leg will cop 6 to 9 times my body weight. I weigh, you know, 95 kilos. You know, some guys are less, some guys are more. So if you think about the weight that goes through my good knee, I guess, and my ankle, it's quite a lot of weight.
I'm interested that you say that you feel at least when you're bowling. So you feel at least when you're actually piling the pressure on.
Yeah, I think it's obviously because the blood's flowing and everything's warm. My first probably 4 or 5 balls really hurt. You know, because I haven't done that for a while, that movement for a while, and so it takes me, you know, it takes me probably an over to get that blood flowing and to get that good feeling back, I guess.
You have pain in your hips and your shoulders yep. as well.
Yeah,
how
I
often?
Have. I've got a hip that probably eventually will require surgery just to clean up, I guess. My shoulders just from the sheer force that we put through, or I put through my shoulder through bowling, and I. You know, a lot of bowlers have got the same sort of thing. We train for it, we lift weights for it, we do a lot of shoulder exercises.
How often would you walk out onto the pitch pain-free?
Oh, never. Something, as I said, it's something, that's why I call it my friend. And when I say me, it's not just me, it's bowlers in general. Every bowler would feel, I'd love to meet a bowler who'd walk out onto a cricket field pain-free. I don't think I've met one yet.
You mentioned first thing in the morning. Sheree, what's he like first thing in the morning?
Oh, sometimes he's a pain. He's a whinger.
He's a pain.
He's a pain, yeah. It takes him a while to get up and get out of bed. He needs a good push while he's playing sometimes, yeah.
Yeah, so what do you think when you watch him running into bowl like that?
I don't know, because you don't... When he's playing, you don't kind of see that. I don't know, yeah.
Mm. It's probably... Again, it's something you're used to. I get up sometimes and say to Sheree, I don't know how I'm going to do it today.
Yeah.
You know, I'm that sore. But once I get up, the first 3 or 4 steps to the shower or to the bathroom, whatever it is, you know, she virtually laughs at me and then probably thinks the same thing. But, you know, after that, every step after that, it literally sort of starts to feel better.
Yeah.
Shelley, you started boxing 5 years ago and now you're a Commonwealth Games gold medalist. Congratulations on that. When an opponent lands a big blow on you when you're boxing... What do you feel?
A lot of the time you don't feel it or you don't feel any pain from it. Obviously, you do feel an impact. But I've had 56 fights now, I think, as well as many, many rounds of comp sparring and stuff like that. And I can only tell you 2 times that I remember an actual pain from the punch.
OK, we're looking at you here. That's you in the red?
Yes.
Yeah, ouch. Ouch again.
You honestly don't. I don't feel it.
You don't feel it at
all? No.
Even when it's right in the face?
Nope. There's only been, like I said, 2 punches in my 4.5 years so far.
Okay, so you're really focused on what you're doing.
Yeah,
is
definitely.
That the same with you, Ryan?
Very similar, yeah. When you're in the moment, I can't imagine boxing, but That to me is too scary. But when you're in the moment, you're right. You don't sort of think about it. You're so focused on what you're trying to do that your mind's working on that, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
All right, David, how can that be? You run training programs at the AIS, the Institute of Sport. How can these two withstand stuff that would floor the rest of us and keep playing elite sport while they've had it happen to them? I mean, how is it they can do that and I bet most of us can't?
Yeah, I think it's a really good question, and a lot of us probably wonder about the precise mechanisms, but from my experience, they're very engaged in a task that they're incredibly committed towards. And so Ryan wants to play cricket, and he wants to win, and he wants to get a wicket, and he wants to help his team win. And so he's so focused on that concept, and the crowd's yelling for him, and the game's going his way, and he's a big part of it. Like Shelley said, thinking about what she's got to do. And so she's like parking that part of processing pain so that she can. Now, I suspect that when she wakes up in the morning, she'll say, wow, my cheek's a little tender. Or she's not pain-free. It's not like either of them can't feel pain. It's just during the heat of the moment. To me, the way I like to think of it is they're just parking the pain. They're distracted from the pain.
You're nodding all the way through that. Yep. That
spot on. Exactly how you feel. You know, you talk about, in my situation, you're out in the middle of the ground. You're doing something that you love, you dream of doing. You've got your teammates there. You've got the crowd there. Adrenaline kicks in. You just don't think about it. The only time you think about it is when you walk off the ground at the end and you are a bit sore, or it's the only time you think about it.
I remember leading into my final fight, because I'd had 3 fights previously at the Commonwealth Games before the final, and I couldn't lift my arms up. And I was thinking to myself, how am I supposed to lift them, put them into my guard and be able to throw the punches at this person? But once you start to warm up and once you realise, you know, you've got a task to do, it just completely goes. And I guess you just let your mental capacity override any of that.
This might be painful for you to watch, actually, but we're going to go to the 2010 Ashes with you running in to bowl. Let's have a look.
I haven't seen this footage for a while.
That's the one that tends to go a little bit more in the air.
Hello. Not a good sign. He has trouble with his knees. I think it was the turf he got caught in on that occasion.
No, it's locked. It's locked again when he gestured there. His bad knee, which has got nothing in it, no cartilage whatsoever, is his right knee. So this looks like a shoe, a foot problem, that's for sure. He was talking to the physio out this morning in warm-ups when he was bowling a few, and he said, yeah, all okay.
What had happened?
Basically, I'd cracked the bottom of my ankle, or the top of my ankle. So basically, leading into that game, I had a little bit of soreness on the top of my, top of my ankle, I guess, that morning, probably an hour and a half before that happened, I actually had an injection into the ankle to try and take that pain away, it worked. I went out and warmed up and everything was good. I'd probably bowled, I think that was my second over of the morning. I actually literally said to Ricky Ponting, who was at mid-on, he said to me, how's your ankle? I said, it's great. And then literally that ball, I ran in it and it just broke. It was a big crack. It was a shock. And I think because I'd had an injection in it, there was some cortisone and local anaesthetic in it. I think that saved me, because once that wore off later that day, I've never felt anything, that the pain I felt, I've never felt anything like before. It was just excruciating.
Okay, so you weren't feeling as much pain then?
No, there, it was, when that it happened. Was, it was, how do you explain it? It was sore, don't get me wrong. Mm. But I walked off the ground. It's obviously a big walk from the MCG. I actually walked off.
And you've played with a broken foot?
Yeah, that was another occasion. It was my first game for Queensland back in Adelaide against South Australia, and one of the South Australian batsmen hit one back along the ground after I'd bowled, and I stuck my foot out to try and stop it.
Stop it.
And I did. I actually kicked it a fair way. I managed to bowl about 4 more overs, and then I stopped my spell and went off and changed a pair of boots. It was feeling sore, but again, it was just being hit by a ball, obviously, you know, can hurt. So,
how do you think you'd have been in backyard cricket if that had happened?
Well, if someone's hitting the ball that hard in backyard cricket, I wouldn't be playing it. But I don't know.
But if you'd hurt, you know.
Yeah, you'd probably you'd stop straight away, I guess. Yeah.
David, yes, Michael.
Just add a couple of quick things. The transmitters that play a part in this process are very, very powerful. One of them is the endorphins, the other is the adrenaline system.
Yep.
and they can produce the sort of pain relief and more that you described,
yep.
so much so that you can actually do bad things under the influence of that.
Yep.
The second thing is, it's not the pain itself that matters, it's the meaning of the pain. Same as when you're bowling. You'll take a lot of pain because you're trying to get another wicket and then another one and another one.
Yep, exactly right.
David, I know that you're interested in the idea of resetting people's pain barriers in sport.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now we've been...
Isn't that dangerous?
It can be. It depends on what stage of development you're involved in. What we're trying to do with athletes that are starting to engage in a sport, like boxing or like cycling, we're trying to grade the process. So we're actually layering in adversity in a graded format.
So layering in hurt?
It is essentially layering in hurt. We're layering in sleep deprivation, like they'd get when they travel overseas. We're layering in long hill climbs, even in the rain, early morning starts.
That's like torture to me.
It sounds like torture, but in fact we're convincing ourselves that it's almost unethical not to allow people to gradually experience
them.
The adversity than to just jump into the adversity. And one of the ways of resetting the pain, the analogy we use a lot is with eating hot peppers or, you know, Tabasco sauce or spicy foods. You might be given a Tabasco sauce and you say, how hot is it on a scale? And, you know, how painful is it? And you say, well, that's a 10, that's really hot. And then you give them a different type of a chili pepper, like that's really hot. And once they eat that, their head nearly explodes. And then you go back to the Tabasco and say, how would you rate that pain again? They're like, well, now that's only a 5. Now, the trick with all this is to keep it safe.
Mm, and every elite sports person I've spoken to, you know, pretty much wants to be out there, particularly in the big matches, regardless of what your physical state is.
Yeah, well, that, and I think cricket's got one of the best medical teams, I think, in the world, around our team at the moment. They're always advising me of the pros and cons, I guess, on going out and playing or not.
But and you ignore them?
Sometimes, yeah. And that's my choice to do that. I'm in control of that. They're not. But they can try and pull me back and say, you're not going out there, but I'll go and do it myself.
Someone else can't tell you how much pain you can handle.
Yeah.
And I think it's very mental, I think, the pain in anybody necessarily. Like, for myself, to get punched in the face, I don't have an issue with it, but I may walk down the hallway and stub my toe, and I'm not anticipating the pain. I'm not ready for it, and so that will absolutely be excruciating. And all you've done is stub your toe in comparison to being punched in the face.
And is that because of the meaning issue that Michael raised?
Yeah.
You know, that you're not in the Commonwealth Games when you stub your toe.
Yeah.
So, Ryan, bone on bone on your knee, what are you like when you stub your toe at home?
Oh, I'm exactly like that, because you don't expect it, I guess. It hurts. One thing that I'm scared of is I've had a number of needles in my time and fluid taken out. The sight of a needle, I almost faint.
But Lorimer, you're a clinical neuroscientist. What does all of this tell the rest of us about pain? We're not elite athletes, but what does this tell us about pain?
I'm just loving the conversation, I might just say. I think I would agree with this emphasis on meaning. But I think the most powerful shift that we can undergo in our own sense of what pain is to let go of this idea of a pain being sent to your brain. Because that doesn't happen. There's no such thing as a pain message. Right? What we're all talking about here is danger signals. And then the brain has to decide, should I protect you here? We've talked about it from the context of the Ashes, you know, this you're doing what you love, or the Commonwealth Gold. My take on that, and one that I think you can defend with confidence, is that it's not in your interests to have pain at that time, because if you did, you would behave in a way to get out of pain.
Exactly.
It's not in your interest, Shelley, to hurt when someone hits you in the face in a title bout.
Yep.
So the brain is so much more clever than I think we give it credit
yeah,
for.
Yeah, now when you say, I want to just rewind here, that when you talk about a pain message, what do you mean? That we don't, you know, that a pain message as such isn't what exists? Because a lot of people, I think that.
I agree.
You get the message to your brain that says you've hurt yourself, you cut your hand, and that's why it hurts.
Yeah. I would just replace pain there with a danger signal. I mean, these ultimately has to be a receptor in the nervous system that detects something's wrong or something's on the verge of being wrong, and it alerts the brain to that message.
All right, you've got a story. Do a show and tell. Come up and tell us your story.
What
happened to you? It's a great story.
Can I do actions? Okay.
Yep. Do the actions. We want the full actions.
Okay. So, hello, everyone. Very intimidating up here. I wish I was as glamorously dressed as you. But I was once walking in the bush down near Mittagong. And I'm going to reenact for you what happened and use that as a way to describe how I think pain works. So, this is me walking in the... I put on my sarong. Very, very cool. And I was walking along. Did you see that? I'll do that in slow motion in case you missed it. I was walking along and... What's actually happened is that something has touched the outside of my leg in the skin, and that's detected by receptors. They're there. They're touch receptors. And they send a touch message to my brain, which and it's very fast. They're like Ferrari fibres, nerve fibres. And it gets to my brain and it says, you've just been touched on the outside of your leg and skin. And meanwhile, whatever it was sufficiently dangerous to activate a totally different type of nerve. And we call these nerves danger receptors or nociceptors, noxious receptors. And they're quite slow and they send a message up into the spinal cord and then goes from there up into the brain. And it tells the brain a slightly different message. And the message is, there's danger on the outside of your leg in the skin. Mate. They're Australian nerves. So then the magic happens. The brain has to evaluate everything really quickly. And it says, where are you? The answer, I'm walking in the bush. Right? Whereabouts in your walking phase are you? I'm about here. Where is the message? It's this far off the ground. Goes to the frontal lobe. Now, the frontal lobe can be a little bit, problematic. It says, well, you needn't worry too much because growing up, you always scratch your legs walking in the bush on twigs and bushes and things like that. So the brain took all of this information really quickly and evaluated the meaning of that, which is, this is not dangerous, kick off the twig and carry on your way. And that's what happened. And I was, I went onto the river and I got out, and then that's the last thing I remember because I'd actually been bitten by an eastern brown snake, which is a really deadly snake, right? So my system let me down. No, a lot of danger, no pain. Can I tell the sequel?
Yeah, quickly.
Okay. The sequel is walking in the bush without a sarong and I scratch my leg. Something touched me on the outside of the leg. The same thing happens, gets to the brain. And the brain says, where are we? We're walking in the bush. What stage of walking are you? You're there, frontal lobe. Anything to tell me? Well, last time we were in this exact situation, it meant a catastrophic scenario. I need to protect you from that and I will make your leg hurt so much because then you cannot do anything but protect your leg, right?
And how did you react?
Well, I always feel self-conscious reenacting the second one because I feel like a bit of a ding.
Bat.
Yeah. But it was excruciating, burning pain, screaming up my leg. And I was thrown off the path. And if you were a health professional...
This is not the snake.
This is not the snake. Yep. This is the twig.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, after.
I agree, it's all about meaning. But I think the key shift that I've seen revolutionise the management of pain around the world is that pain is produced by your brain to make you protect yourself.
Mm.
And if protection is not the best thing right now, it won't hurt.
Show us what you mean. You've got another show and tell that you're going to do.
What we might do is stroke there and it might feel a bit numb.
Ryan, you lost your right hand in an accident more than a decade ago, but you say you can still feel it.
Yes.
Describe that for me. What do you mean?
Sure. Well, the terminology is phantom pain, and ever since the accident first took place, it's always been there. It's quite obvious for me. I'm missing my right hand, and for me, it feels like everything is still there in its complete form and structure.
So what do you feel?
In terms of how it first felt, it was quite excruciating because through the course of the accident,
It involved me holding a bottle as tight as could be. And when I first lost my hand, the feeling was as if I was just
like
constantly
like
gripping a bottle as tight as possibly could.
So, and is the pain associated with the accident?
Essentially, yes. Yeah, it is, absolutely. And that whole feeling of clenching onto a bottle as tight as can be is the very last moment that, the very last action that my hand was doing as I lost it. And it's interesting, it was actually through a course of the mirror box therapy, which I went through some years ago.
What's that?
So it's effectively a box which allows me to put both limbs, i.e. my hand and wrist, into a space. And through a course of mirrors, they were able to replicate what was a reverse image of my left hand. So as I looked down into the box, I effectively saw a right hand, which was just a mirror copy of my left. But very interestingly enough, given that association and feeling like the hand is still there, it was almost like an innate response that as soon as I started moving my left fingers, my right finger started to move in sync as well. And the feeling matched up with the visuals matched up with the actual sensation. And to come back to your question of what happens when you go and touch where the non-existent hand is, if you now go like this on my fingers, I actually get that tingling sensation in that finger. And I know it seems strange, and I'm just tickling thin air, and I can look at it, but the feeling is
still there.
But you're
getting the feeling. So if you dive into cold water, are you feeling it on both hands, a phantom hand and your real left hand?
Yes, absolutely. It's as if you're sticking your hand into a bucket of ice water. Mm. I get that pain through, again, that non-existent hand.
How constant is the pain, that pain you describe?
It's 100% of the time. It's always there. And like I said, it's probably always going to be there. But through different courses of action and learnings, just as like the mirror box therapy, I feel like I've got this ability to engage with it.
Lorimer, what's going on here? I mean, with that feeling, that sensation, that notion that it's there, that it's locked in that position it was in when the accident happened.
Yeah, that's quite a common report. It's really important to understand that your brain produces the sensation, and all of our sensations are like that. In one way, to try and grasp that, Ryan has an advantage because he knows he feels his hand, but he also knows his hand is missing. All of us know we feel our body, but our body's there, so it's hard to understand that this is just a creation of the brain.
Show us what you mean. You've got another show and tell that you're going to do. And we've got a volunteer, Andrew. He's not a plant. We've asked just a member of the audience to join us. And I think we've got something coming on here.
All right, I'm just going to drape this over your shoulder. And I can talk people through this. So here we have a rubber hand. It's an unclaimed prosthetic hand. And I'm going to align this with your hand. So we cover the main piece of information you people can't see over the other side. We've just covered the end of that rubber hand. And
your hand's shaking just a bit, Andrew.
It's a rubber
it's
hand.
All right.
It's shaking, possibly. And if you close your eyes, Andrew, and just point with your left hand where your right hand is. All right. Good. Now you can open your eyes. I'm going to just stroke your fingers. All right, and I want you to watch somewhere around here. You can watch this brush if you like. All right, now as Andrew's watching that, what we're doing is telling his brain that the stimulus he can see here is the same as the stimulus that's coming from the touch system. And if we keep doing that, then Andrew will start to sense something a bit odd going on. All right, so we go around that a little bit. The important thing is that his brain is getting the information together. And then we can just come in and do that. We give him a real shock.
You okay?
Yeah.
You really jumped then.
So,
wow.
Well done, Andrew. Well done. So all we've done there, Jenny, is a really...
Are you okay?
Yeah.
What did you... Tell me what it was like. What did you feel like?
Just like a sudden jolt. Like, not even like it didn't... heard it all afterwards, but when he hit it, I felt like something was going to happen, but then didn't.
Okay, so did
and
you...
And then the illusion is broken straight away because the brain's got two bits of information. Yeah.
So what's happening there?
Well, Andrew's brain is clearly a very clever one and can quickly integrate what's most sensible. And it's most sensible that the visual input, it's happening at the same time as the touch input. Then the brain says, well, clearly this is the stimulus that I'm seeing on the rubber hand. That's the stimulus. And that's not true, but we've tricked your brain. And there are many illusions like that. And these sort of illusions have been around for 100 years.
The question is, what else can you do with it? For other people, what can you train your brain to think differently about pain?
You absolutely can. And I think that that's really the most powerful tool available to humankind to reduce pain. The problem, Jenny, is that it's really difficult to train the brain, not to protect you, because that's a life and death situation.
Okay, let's all move back to our spots. Thank you very much, Andrew.
Thanks, Andrew.
For that.
No, cheers.
Yeah, a round of applause for Andrew. Michael.
Lest if we thought that this is all sort of phenomena, we know quite a lot about what happens with amputation. Neuroplasticity is really important in this sort of pain. And what happens when you lose a hand is that the area in your brain that normally represents the lips moves across in the brain to occupy the area that was previously occupied by the hand. Why does it do this? The brain's got to keep getting information. Without information, it can't do the sorts of things we've talked about earlier on today. Now, we've done some work with spinal cord injury patients and found that the amount of this neuroplasticity change is directly proportional to how much pain the patient has. So it provides a method now with special brain scanning, not the standard scanning, but research scanning. It gives a method of evaluating new methods which will overcome that sort of problem.
Mm. Anne, you had a knee reconstruction 5 years ago. What happened afterwards?
Well, I had really bad osteoarthritis in my knee, so I had a knee replacement. And after the surgery, the pain in my leg just got worse and worse and worse. But then my leg started to change colour and went purple, so I went back to the doctor, who put me on some pretty heavy-duty painkillers. Then I went back to hospital.
There's your leg there.
Yeah, it's very attractive, isn't it? as we move through this, I went into hospital and I was really lucky, I guess, that I was diagnosed with complex regional pain syndrome.
What's that?
It's a condition that results in agonising pain that's not equal to the causal event, basically.
Tell me what the pain was like. What was it like?
The pain is like someone has filled your leg with molten metal. It's a burning pain that's just...
And there all the time?
Yeah. Some days, like today, it's not that bad. Probably on a scale of 1 to 10, the pain today is about a 4. Sometimes people say, well, you know, what's your pain at today? And I'll say 58. And they look at me as if I'm joking, but that's where it is some days.
And you say it's spread? This
it's spread into my left
spread.
Arm, side of my neck now.
Okay. Had you heard of this syndrome before?
No. And one of the worst things was I'd never heard of it before. One of the nurses in the hospital initially gave me a printout from the internet and all I saw was excruciating pain and there's no cure.
That's not very encouraging, right?
No. So for about the first 6 months, I barely left the house. I was working previous to that, so I had to give up work.
And the word chronic had a big impact on you,
yes? Yes, yeah. Chronic, how long is this going to last? Will I be better tomorrow? Will I be able to go back to work?
Yeah, so a complete mystery. Michael, you are a pain specialist. Tell us what this thing is, complex regional pain syndrome.
Quite obviously it causes chronic pain. It's one of the rather more complicated causes, so that's why it's called complex. And the complex means that it affects the sensory system, it affects the motor system. So, for example... the patient might have a tremor. They might have a lot of trouble with the disconnect between their brain and their limb. They suddenly find they really can't move the hand very much or it responds very slowly. And that's pretty disconcerting.
And what causes it? Why do some people get it and other people don't?
We don't entirely know the answer to that question. However, it appears that this is partly due to genetic predisposition, and this is also probably the case with a lot of post-trauma and post-surgical pain. But it's not just genetics by itself. There has to be a key interaction between that genetic predisposition and the environment.
Mm. So how treatable is it? How do you treat it?
Look, we have very, very few good tools for this condition, and we've got to be honest with patients about that. There are some things in the field of pain that we really don't often do very well, and this is one of them, I'm afraid.
Do we know the extent to which the brain can play a role in this?
Oh, we know that a lot of this is going on in the brain. So I referred to neuroplasticity. This is neuroplasticity in spades. The brain has become tricked into thinking there's something that needs a response that's not a helpful response. It's a maladaptation. So you've got to get it to go back the other way.
How do you do that?
Well, you do that firstly by invoking the motor system. You've got to get weight bearing going in the lower limb and to a certain extent in the upper limb. You've got to get as full a range of normal activities going as possible. Very often, if it's an upper limb, you get a frozen shoulder. You've got to get in really early to prevent that frozen shoulder and re-educate the muscles how to work. You can do things such as desensitization. Try to get the patient to overcome the extreme sensitivity that I assume you must have had.
Yep, I still get that, but sometimes, for instance, I can't wear a pair of jeans because I can't stand the weight of the jeans on my leg. So
and also in water, you said.
Water,
cold water. Water.
Just what? Absolutely. What it's does like it feel standing like? In ground glass and the glass swirling around your leg.
Wow.
It is just agonising.
Then there are what we call cognitive behavioural strategies. So giving the patient correct information about what's going on and what you really can do that's likely to help.
Terry, you're Anne's husband. How did you react to this diagnosis? What did you think was going on with her leg when this happened?
Well, I didn't believe it. I thought that they'd done something wrong. I thought they'd left something in there.
Oh, right.
A pair of scissors or something in there because she was in so much pain. And
you did check that they hadn't left.
Yeah, well, I guess they did.
Yeah.
But I couldn't check, so, yeah. And yeah. And then after talking to doctors and things with my wife about it, and I still don't understand what it is really, but, you know, she's always in pain.
Yeah, but it must have really surprised you to see her leg change that and to see that kind of severe.
And it was like, not only was it the colour and all, it was hard. It was like rock hard. Mm.
How did friends react to this?
Our friends are full of useful advice. Some friends are full of useful advice. They say things like, have you tried acupuncture? Have you tried, you know, whatever, hypnotherapy, all of that. And yes, you do try all of those alternate sort of things. After the spinal cord stimulator made the pain worse, I said to the doctor, the pain specialist, just turn it off, just leave it there. And he said, I think you should see a psychologist. Well, I went home in tears. I said to Terry, he thinks I'm mad. Seeing the psychologist was probably the single best intervention that I did.
Why?
She taught me that I wasn't going mad in the first place because sometimes I used to think I was going crazy. Sometimes I'd look at my hand and think, oh, that's not my hand. That's not my arm.
This is the disconnect.
Yeah, that's not my leg. She taught me how to deal with all of that, and she also taught me about mindfulness.
What's mindfulness for people who don't know?
My layman's definition of it is what it is. I have got pain and I have to live with that pain and you just connect with that pain.
Mm. So did that mindfulness decrease the pain or alleviate the pain for you? Did it help?
It helped. It helped the pain. It helped me cope with the pain, I guess. And then through talking it through with my pain specialist, and we talked, I was on lots of narcotics and opiates. We decided that wasn't the way to go, so I've stopped all that. And I'm going back to a rehab program and, yeah.
So what are you doing now? When you feel that pain, what do you do?
Well, once upon a time, I would panic. I don't panic anymore. It is what it is. Okay, this is bad. Is it because I've done too much? If it's not that I've done too much, I must be having a bad pain day, a bad flare. And you just move through it. And instead of not doing anything, maybe just do a little bit. Might go for 4 or 5 days where I don't sleep because of the pain. And again, use the mindfulness, it is what it is.
I didn't want my parents to find out that I'd injured myself, so I stitched up my right arm, and I'm right-handed, so I had to do it left-handed at the time with some fishing line.
Okay, lots of intake of breath here. Steve Peach in Oregon, you have an altogether different problem with pain. What is it?
Well, I was born with a rare genetic condition where I do not feel physical pain.
At all?
At all.
Ever? No matter what happens to your body or no matter what you go through, you don't feel anything?
Nope. No broken bones or any, cuts or anything like that. Nothing at all.
And your late brother Chris had this genetic condition as well?
Yes, he did.
What was it like for you as kids to start with? Because kids engage in all kinds of risky behaviour. What was it like for you? What sort of things happened?
Well, we would kind of take things a little bit to the extreme, like riding bicycles down a steep driveway and using each other as jump and, climbing high trees, jumping out of them, jumping off of rooftops, all kinds of things.
And how often would you get hurt, seriously hurt, as a result of doing those things because you couldn't feel the pain?
Well, so far, I'm 33 years old and I've had probably over 70 broken bones so far in my life. So, and the majority of those happened during my childhood between birth to about 14 or 15, so
how
quite frequently.
How did your parents cope with it? What did they tell you?
I think my parents still haven't coped with it, but they deal with it the best that they can. They made a point to discuss with my brother and I ways of trying to detect injury, being that we don't feel pain, and they just watched us as much as they could, but tried to give us some kind of independence.
Brothers often fight physically. What were your fights like when you had fights with one another?
We usually involve objects, whichever were in the room, for weapons against each other, sometimes knives and, a shovel or a crowbar, or whatever was nearby at the time.
Wow, so some very serious injuries you must have had, both of you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, quite a lot.
Mm. And you would stitch up your own injuries sometimes as a child?
Yeah, I didn't want my parents to find out that I'd injured myself, so I stitched up my right arm. And I'm right-handed, so I had to do it left-handed at the time with some fishing line.
Okay, lots of intake of breath here. And at one stage, you were actually removed from your parents' care. Is that right? Because the authorities thought that you were being abused.
Yeah, I was quite young when that happened. Back then, when someone came, saying, hey, my child doesn't feel pain, this is why they have all these injuries, it was a little bit harder to believe than what it is now. And that information, even though it was being provided to authorities by a physician, it was still being overlooked for quite some time, about 3 months before I was returned to my parents.
Wow. What do you understand pain to be?
I'm asked that quite a lot. And it would probably be as if I were to ask someone what it would be like to live without pain. Their first reaction would probably be, oh, that'd be a fantastic thing to live life without feeling pain. But then they start to think about it and they go, well, maybe there is a downside to not feeling pain. And then if you were to ask me that question, I'd say, well, maybe feeling pain would be great. But then now that I've got all these injuries, feeling pain would be quite a horrible experience. So I really try not to give too much thought about pain or what it would be like to live my life with pain.
So your wife, for example, gets migraines, I understand.
Yeah.
Can you empathise
in
any way with that? Do you have the capacity to empathise, because you can't know what it's, what pain's like. So how can you know what she's going through?
I think my empathy more towards my wife and my children is more of like a learned behaviour than anything. It's not something I'm really, that I do naturally when I experience someone who's going through a painful situation. So it's kind of difficult for me.
Mm. And what about internal things that you can't see? Something like appendicitis or...
Yeah, appendicitis is the one thing I worry about the most. But something more recent that had occurred with me was my T8 and T9 vertebrae were fractured. And I went probably 7 or 8 months not even knowing that it had occurred. I just had a little bit of discomfort. And then once I found out about it, then I had to go ahead and go through a whole list of procedures to try to remedy it, or try to remedy it as best as I could. It wasn't even until like a week ago when I finally recalled what it was I had done to myself that had caused the injury. So,
which was? What had you done?
It was really stupid. We were out in the parking lot. It was snowing, so there was a good foot and a half of snow. And we were out there with my children. We were all inner tubing down the hillside, and I kind of did like a run and a jump on the inner tube, and I just kind of bent my back in an awkward position. And that's what it was. I had fractured my T8, my T9 vertebrae.
Yes, questions here, yes.
I have one question. In athletes, we're always trying to understand discomfort versus pain. And I wonder if you have any sensations. Do you feel pressure, or do you feel cold, or do you feel heat, or do you... I'm wondering how you differentiate.
Yeah, I feel discomfort, heat, cold. Like with my left knee, for example, I've had 3 arthroscopic surgeries on it from the time I was 14 years old until the time I was about 17. It's swollen to about the size of a grapefruit now. And I've got constant discomfort with it. It's just bone rubbing on bone all the time. I can feel the pressure from the swelling. And if I'm moving, then I can feel the bone kind of grinding on bone. So it's different from what my right knee is experiencing, which is normal movement. So it's just that those two differences.
But it's not hurting. It's just a sensation of discomfort. Ryan, how do you control your pain, all that pain you feel when you're bowling?
It's a very good question. I guess I'm so used to it. I guess that's how I control it. But
Do you take drugs?
I have taken Panadeine Forte. I constantly take Voltaren to control that inflammation.
How often?
When I'm playing and training, I take Voltaren morning and night. Panadeine Forte, I only take when I play to try and control that pain.
And have you ever tried anything like mindfulness or meditation?
I haven't. Must admit, I haven't. I'm very fascinated listening to people using it. Mm. I use psychology. I'm a psychologist quite a lot. More about how to get through, what to think, and how to get through certain situations where I think I'm struggling, or I think my body's struggling.
Mm. How much does your emotional state affect the extent of the pain that you feel?
Enormous.
Or does it at all?
Controls it.
David, do you think it does?
Yeah, there it is. And here's a real interesting scenario that plays out in the sporting world. I stumbled across this this concept of a therapeutic presence, that some people connect with another person who's in pain very well. And this is all very emotional. They're on that emotional level where they really connect with the person with the pain, and they have the empathy, and they give them hope. Whatever they do works.
Mm, Anne, you're nodding your head there, yeah.
Just in terms of, do your emotions play a part in this? I know around the time that my dad was dying, my pain was much worse because I wasn't attending to it, if you like. I was very emotional, I was very upset, and the pain was off the scale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Lorimer?
I completely agree with that. And we can link that, not just to emotion in a fluffy way, but when you have a feeling, you change the biochemistry of your body, and that changes the way neurons work. Pain is so complex and so personal, and we all really want to understand what it's like for Steve and want him to understand what it's like for us. But I can't understand what it's like for you, your pain, because it's not mine. It's an internal thing. And we find ourselves describing our pain in terms of the injury, because then someone else can understand it. So, you know, Ryan's talking about bone on bone in there. And then we all get it. But we're having to describe it in terms of danger, not in terms of pain, because it's this internal thing. All of these complex things move into it, and I think you can say, well, actually, it's simple. The brain evaluates what tells me I'm safe and what tells me I'm in danger and needs to protect. Oh. And that can be anything, not just the sensory information. If we know that people with a car accident and they have a sore neck and everything's going well in their rehab and they go back to that roundabout where they had their accident and their pain comes on, that's completely sensible to someone who understands biology. Hmm. There's nothing illegitimate or unreal about that pain.
But the question is, what can you do with that knowledge to help people like Anne or to help people who have ongoing pain? Leslie, you're getting agitated up here, and I know that you've had chronic osteoarthritis since your 30s and you're in your 70s now. What I'm interested in, because I know that you're very active in this area, you know, as an advocate, and what I'm interested in is what you make of this idea of the role of the brain and might mean for anyone.
Well, Jenny, that's actually pain. Where we are at today. We have good evidence now that people who undergo what we call pain programs, which is a multidisciplinary program where they learn firstly to understand their own pain and the causes of it and the drivers of it, the triggers for it, and then learn techniques to manage it, such as the techniques we've talked about, meditation, mindfulness, gentle exercise, managed exercise. Psychological therapies like cognitive behavioural therapy play a major role in pain programs. And fortunately, we're now starting to see them introduced.
You want pain to be considered a disease, don't
not,
you?
No, not necessarily, Jenny. For me, I think that's an academic debate. I mean, for me, chronic pain is a very nasty, insidious chronic condition. It is relentless, it is not curable, it is debilitating and disabling, and it's a terrible burden on the health system and the economy. So it needs to be a healthcare priority, but it does not need necessarily to be recognised as a disease. I think the government, federal government, state and federal governments, all recognise it as a chronic medical condition, which is eligible to be treated under a chronic disease care plan. So theoretically, you can get allied professional help to learn some of these techniques under Medicare.
Michael, do you think chronic pain should be considered to be a condition in its own right?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's a vast amount of evidence of maladaptations that occur in the brain. We're just now starting to get evidence in the spinal cord, which has been very hard to get in humans, but it is there. There's evidence of abnormalities in the functioning at the receptor level, at the body surface. Damages the spinal nerves, go into the spinal cord. I'm very comfortable with calling it a condition. It makes no difference. It just needs to be recognised.
OK, but a disease or a condition. Lorimer, I know that you've got a problem with that idea. Why?
I agree with Michael that there's very good evidence that chronic pain is associated with these changes. But I think it puts a ceiling on our hope and our possibility, and I think that ceiling is already being shifted upwards with the advances that are happening in the different pain sciences.
Look, I must disagree with you that this will stifle progress. I think looking very hard at the disease processes that have currently been discovered and more that are being discovered, we will get some new options for treatment. And that's what we need. We need more tools to help people.
I wanted to see if there was a comment. It's Leslie, I think, that there's a lot of attention on the person who's suffering with pain. I'm a support person in my role with athletes. I wonder, is there something that the people that care for people with pain, or the spouse or the partner or the brother or the sister, is there any words of wisdom on how to cope and deal with someone who's suffering with pain?
Well,
you don't talk about it, I know, because we did a whole interview with you for this show and you didn't talk about your own situation at all, which I found really interesting.
Well, I think that there is a very simple reason for that, Jenny, and that is, you know, that I recognise the stigma that's attached to chronic pain. People perceive them as weak, as not able to cope, as quite pathetic, in fact, if they don't deal with pain. pain is invisible, so you can't actually see always what is wrong with somebody. So you think that they are imagining it. You know, people think you're imagining it, so it's not talked about.
What's the best thing you can do to help?
Well, I think you listen and you believe them initially is a starting point. And if people say they're in pain, then simply believe them. Yeah. Accept that and try to be supportive and not be critical.
And what have you learnt about managing your pain now, do you think?
I think I've learnt that it is what it is.
And Ryan, what about you? What do you think you've learnt about your own?
What I do causes what the pain I've got. The only way I can stop the real pain that I get is to finish and stop what I do.
And I don't, what are the chances of that?
And that's not happening. I love doing what I do. I've got the best job in the world. I know before I walk onto the field, I know that when I walk off, I'm going to be sore and painful. So it is what it is, and I deal with it.
And how are you feeling about making the Ashes team?
Oh, it's exciting, yeah. And that's something that I've had a chance of winning the Ashes. I've got injured and lost the Ashes. I want to win them again, and that's the drive for me to keep going. And the pain takes a back seat to that. Mm.
Thanks so much for joining us. Thank you to everybody for joining us for this discussion. It's been fascinating.
The whole culture of medicine is slow to share information, slow to recognise we don't know it all.
I have very clear memories of hiding in the toilet with my son's file because they didn't like to give it to you and they didn't like you to look at it.
And how much is that costing the system then? That is all we have time for, but we will see you next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone. Great.